And if you can put the newest member in a bit of an uncomfortable position, it can play into your favor quite well. I think Zach may also be a point of contention, and maybe even that Jungle Calm. I think those would be the highlight champions so far.
Well, so far, you're not too far wrong in there. We're going to see Sona banned out here for EG along with Shen. Malphite towards Wicked, Thresh towards Crepo, and Ahri against Froggen right now for Gambit.
That's actually a very brave call, or a pretty directed ban from Gambit, the Malphite. Wicked's played it 7 times out of the 20 games this split, yeah. And he's also played Zach 7 times, and there's so much discussion around Wicked Zach, and I think it's because he's had so many topsy-turvy performances. Some games he's had zero impact, and some where he has dominated the matchup. One of the things we do see has been left open is Twisted Fate, and we'll have to see if Gambit decides to go for it.
And Elise as well, another champion which Gambit are definitely not scared of running. Darien has played a fair bit of Elise himself, and you know, it was Shaka that actually brought out the Elise for Evil Geniuses in there, the first victory that they had with him over in Tenerife as well, but that will be taken away. Of course, it does leave the likes of Jason right now, who, you know, he's had that hit, obviously, and the changes to team in particular, but he is still pretty strong.
Yeah, the thing about the changes to Tia, even though it does take away some of his power, it just delays it, really.
Yeah.
You know, the power, the damage it still puts out, it still gets to that point. It just takes a couple minutes longer. The one thing is, there's so many power picks open. This is basically like two teams with, you know, unlimited funds in Candyland. Well, what do you want to do? Who are we going to grab first? And I think EG are talking about Jace, talking about Twisted Fate, maybe even talking about Zach, because we know how much Wicked does like to play those comfort picks, and I think that's where all the discussion is for the team right now.
And what's the Zach pickup then? Obviously going with the Nami as well, which we skipped over. That's going to be for Crepo after that Thresh was taken out, after Sona was banned out. So interesting to see where Voidal goes with this one. Right now, Gambit are going to go with Jarvan and Twitch. Now, Jarvan is 100% win ratio here for Diamond, and that's 5 games out of 5 he's won with Jarvan. That's some great statistics.
Even more importantly, denying that from Snoopy is even bigger. Snoopy, a player that hasn't necessarily had the ability to make impacts in games on many other champions, yeah, to a same level that he has had with that Jarvan. We have been seeing Shaka trending towards the Xin Zhao in the Jarvan as his sort of primary pick, so that might be a consideration here for EG. We're down to the, you know, third last round of picks. Jace is still available, and Froggen plays a terrifying Jace. We've seen him pick up wins time and time again throughout the split. So I want to see if they don't want to maybe pick that up for this composition.
We should also mention the Twitch on EG's side of things as well. Froggen been playing a lot of Twitch recently. Yellow Pete definitely not scared of going in there with the Twitch either. So let's see how this one goes. Right now it looks like we're going to be seeing a Nasus being picked up for Snoopy in the jungle. Now, you know, Nasus, he is a comfortable champion for a lot of these players. I mean, the spring split was his real big playing ground, so to speak. He was picked in a lot of games there. Snoopy gonna have him this time around, and then the Vayne pickup for Yellow Pete. Oh, that surprises me somewhat, I have to say.
So Vayne, a champion we wouldn't really associate with Yellow Pete. He does tend to play the slightly longer range, maybe a little bit more sort of passive champions, but we've been seeing a lot of the AD carries in Europe trending towards Vayne over the last couple of weeks. I think basically every single team has run him at some points, including now. EG's composition doesn't really have a lot of very obvious synergies, but they can complement each other in certain ways. I want to see how much of an impact Snoopy's going to have against Gambit, because Jarvan is a pretty hard counter. You lock him in Cataclysm, you knock him up with, you know, the EQ combo, and you just walk away. And we'll have to see how Snoopy finds his engagements.
Well, let's see. Gambit not messing around here with the picks. For me, that looks like they've got a very solid plan that they're sticking to for this one. Orianna coming out for Alex Itch at this point of things. And we saw him back in Moscow picking up Orianna for pretty much the first time that we've really seen it. And he was absolutely terrifying. Went on to play another great Orianna game after that. He's going to have it here as well against EG. Question is now, what is Froggen going to go for in that mid lane against the world is his oyster.
You know, Ahri was banned out, so it would have been the counter that we've been seeing. Whenever Orianas are locked in, we tend to see Ahri being the counter pick, just trying to, you know, avoid the ball as best as possible and try burst them out. Jace, Twisted Fate are still up, and for Gambit, they've got a very good composition here in terms of the ball delivery system. You've got mobility, you've got utility from Lulu, from Orianna. Like, there's a lot of synergy within their composition. At the moment, Froggen was thinking about the Anivia, and I'm happy he swapped that over because he's had very poor results with Anivia. Zero wins, and I think he's played it three times the split already. So swapped it out, going to go to their Kassadin, which is another champion that's been picked up and trending everywhere at the moment. Even over in NA, Cloud9 is starting to play Kassadin, and their reason for it? EU plays Kassadin.
Yeah, and the thing is, the Cassidins that we've seen have, you know, whilst not being 100% win ratio, they have caused a lot of problems for a lot of teams. The mobility of Cassidin is the real devastating thing to try and keep a hold of that one. And we'll see if Gambit actually decide to go with a teleport here to probably get Froggen out of that game on that respect and make sure that they can still have that mobility around the map. He is running the teleport right now, Froggen, so we'll see about that one. But we're going to see Wicked returning here to Zac in the top lane. We've actually seen him running playing a lot of Renekton actually recently. Obviously an old champion when it comes to Wicked's repertoire, but going for Zac here once again.
So I quite like the pickup of Zac. It is a nice utility-based champion. It's going to give them the long-range initiation that they need. And for a composition like this, with the Zac, the Nasus, the Cassidy, and the Vayne, it's actually a little different to what we usually see from Evil Geniuses. It's champions that I wouldn't necessarily associate with the team in that order. So we'll see how well they can make this one work out for them. You know, it's do or die time. They are still in the playoffs, which is great, but they want to be getting that higher seed so they can basically guarantee a spot at Worlds, or make it easier at least.
Well, Evil Geniuses, you know, they've been very vocal about this whole, we've been very vocal even about the whole six-man roster really that they're going with there. That's obviously to discount and rated from the actual roster itself, who's doing a lot of work behind the scenes when it comes to the analysis and preparing the team and, you know, pointing out their weak spots, which is what someone who, you know, an ex-Fnatic player can come into Evil Geniuses and probably do really, really well.
Yeah, we'll see how well it works out for them because, of course, the analyzing of the weak spots is fantastic. If you've got the theory crafting, you have to implement it in the matchup. And I guess it's it's perform or, you know, notch up another loss. The one thing that we are noticing as the loading screen is coming up, Gambit do not have any exhausts on their team. And when you're coming up against a Cassidy and a Vayne, who's going to be coming at you in the mid to late game, that's a pretty scary prospect. The one thing we do see, 3 ignites. So expect lots of early lane pressure and probably going for kills early on.
No teleport, though. We shouldn't point that one out. Froggen did go with that teleport here for Evil Geniuses, and we are in-game then. So let's have a little bit of a talk about level one here, because if you look over for EG, you know, you've got the bubble, which is the real thing that stands out CC-wise across pretty much both teams. Obviously, you've got the cocoon in there for Darien that could get involved as well.
And in terms of both of the teams, you do have some hard CC, but It's very risky for both prospects. If Darien wanted to start with his cocoon, could lock somebody up. You have the bubble, you have Glitter Lance that could work out. But it's because there's nothing to follow up after that, I don't think we're going to see any sort of level one type of pressure or diving onto one another. I do want to remind everybody that this is on 3.9. Kepo's been caught out. The flag toss goes down. He manages to get away. He's got his flash available, but that's a lot of damage early.
Yeah, damage coming in, but you can see that going to be able to walk away. Drops down that bubble there in the end. Not using his flash, which is the real key thing in that scenario. Making sure that he's got that one for later. Gambit all up in EG's jungle.
Yeah, we actually seen that was Kripo just trying to get a ward. It wasn't even too deep of a ward. That was just on the opposite side of the river. He takes all of that damage and decides to, you know, manages to get away. If Gambit had been tighter stacked, or if Gambit had been poising themselves for a red buff invade, that could have been first blood.
So things quiet and down here for the start of things. Looks like we are going to be seeing those lane swaps coming in, which, funny enough, will probably put us back to, you know, the standard 1v1 down in the bottom lane this time with the Elise versus Zac, and then the duos going into the top side. But right now, Evil Genius is coming over to the blue buff. They've got Snoopy there. Voidal actually checking out here in the brush, and we'll see if he's able to do enough damage to force them off.
So we've seen right now the rest of the lanes have not responded until this very second. Genja slowly moving down. The bubble from Kripo will hold Voidal in place, but Snoopy manages to steal away that blue buff, and that's a very good early play. We'll see whether or not Diamond responds in kind by going to EG's blue.
Well, I certainly would expect him to do that one, and we can see on the minimap that he is going to be crossing over right now, up at level 2, of course, after taking his red buff, and is going to be sliding straight through from that one. Don't really see too much pressure coming back from Evil Geniuses to stop this one going down, so it's going to be a pretty standard trade here on the boss.
Yeah, they don't have the numbers advantage on that side of the map, so even if Gambit wanted to reply, Darien would have to take a very long walk, or Aleksic would have to step back from the early game presence against the Cassidy, and basically because Cassidy gets that power at level 6, you want to shut him down as hard as you can as early as possible. The one thing that was great there from Diamond, he even steals away the big wolf.
Yeah, taking away most of that camp and That will leave a little bit less for Snoopy to come back around on. We can see here Alex in that mid lane, starting out Crystalline Flask, the Doran Shield start for Froggen, which now become more and more popular here, just for the fact, especially with Cassidy, that you're gonna have trouble, especially against someone, you know, whilst not being AD based. But those auto attacks from Orianna do hurt, and Cassidy struggles to get in there and keep that farm up with a constant harass.
Yeah, Orianna in particular, I stand to be corrected, but I think she's one of the only champions that all five of her abilities, the passive plus four, scale off AP, and that additional on-hit magic damage hurts a lot at early levels. Up in the top lane, there is a very big creep wave pushing against Yellow Pete and Crepo. As you see, Diamond Proxies managed to get in the lane, or about to pressure. Wicked's very deep without vision.
Yeah, and inside of that brush, sometimes hard to tell if Zach's actually in there or just dead on the edges, but obviously was inside of there. And Diamond is still waiting for this one. Double buffs running. Will he be able to get in onto Wicked, who's now up towards level 3? Is Froggen actually going aggressive here on towards Alex Itch? And as you can see on the minimap there, we saw the back off from Diamond down in this bottom lane. So he's not going to get involved there. May have to come over and cover for Alex Itch, who's a little bit out of position.
Yeah, Snoopy was concerned about chasing the jungle for the double lane, but we do see Alex and Froggen going toe-to-toe. Here come the junglers. A flash away from Froggen.
Flash away, and now Snoopy a little bit out of position with this one, but he should, by all rights, be safe from that one. Froggen going to be forced to recall on that one, and that's going to give Alex even more time here to build up something in this mid lane in terms of farm. The top lane, the duos, Genja actually stealthing up there to go in on towards Crepo. Interesting to see how this one all breaks down. We can see the ELOP, as we said, not exactly the vein. Is a teleport is coming in here from Froggen, only at level 4 right now, though, so not really able to follow on with the damage after that. Didn't have a flash either.
Voidal was sitting in the bush when the teleport got started, so as he was backing away, managed to see the animation and got cleanly away. The thing is, Yellow Pete and Crepo are taking so much damage and harassed from Genja and Voidal. If they overstay their bounds, they may be at risk of giving away first blood.
Let's see about that one. A Snoopy going in on towards Diamond. Does have that red buff still up to him. Obviously took it a little bit later than Diamond, who started with his red. But in the end, no first blood coming in after 5.5 minutes from this one. And I think a lot of the games that we're going to be seeing this weekend will be very similar in terms of we're at a very risky point of the season to be making mistakes.
Yeah, there's so much on the line right now that they simply can't afford to get caught out. And one of the things that has happened is that with the Ignite being down for Alex Itch in the mid lane and Froggen burning his teleport, there is a little bit of safety for respective players. Froggen is not going to get insta-burst quite as easily, and Gambit can continue to apply focus on the lanes. Oh, Yellow Pete's taking a lot of damage in this top lane.
Yeah, Genja actually going in onto him there with that stealth up, but Yellow Pete forced to back away from that one. Looks like he might be recalling. Actually, he's headed back towards the golems there. Just a lifesteal a little bit that back up in this one. And he's quite a way behind if you look at the CS numbers now.
I think that may have been more of the reason for picking up those double golems, because he's suffering in terms of CS numbers. And that's all because of Voidal's positioning. He's sitting in front of the minion wave and trying to control it. Genja's about to walk in there. Here comes Snoopy.
Oh, this could be dangerous. Exhaust is down. Snoopy going to be going in. Voidal gets away somewhat, but the bubble lands on towards Genja, who's already used the barrier. And there is first blood. It's Crepo that picks it up.
Yellow Pete just miscalculating the damage there on the Condemn. Knocks him away, and thanks to the ebb and flow from Crepo, secures first blood for his team. With this massive minion wave, this is going to be a lot of damage on the tower.
Yeah, we'll see if they can actually take this one down with that as well. Snoopy obviously going to be queuing away on that whenever he possibly can. He's already lost half his health, and as you said, a big minion wave in there for that one, and that should be the first tower of the game. Right now, Gambit have got a two-man team on the middle tower, but obviously not going to be able to take it down quite as fast as EG in this scenario.
Now, we'll see the Demacian standard going down from Jarvan to just help Orianna with the auto attacks. Yellow Pete realizing that if they keep that tower up a little bit longer, it'll close that CS gap between Genja and Yellow Pete. Tower finally drops, and the question is now, what do EG do with the duo lane? Do they continue focusing the top, or do they rotate around and allow, you know, Darien, if he goes top, to farm up that way?
We'll have to find that one out. Darien is still right now at bottom, as is Wicked. There's a big wave of minions coming in there that Wicked will be wanting to get his paws on, that's for sure. But Darien trying just to keep him out of range there as much as he possibly can. It is 52-43 in there, and now Darien He's got that range advantage, which naturally is going to give him that early, early bit of a spike when it comes to being able to pick up the farm.
Yeah, and he's probably got about 8 to 12 CS in front of him as well. So Wicked will close those numbers as the wave pushes against his tower. In actual fact, we do see EG moving their jaw lane bottom, which is sort of the standard thing to do when you get an early tower. You allow your solo laner to face off against what is effectively going to be your opponent's solo laner, as it looks like Darren is maybe even poising himself towards that top lane as well.
Yeah, Darren realizing what's going on with this one and actually coming back up through the mid lane. So we'll see what the plan is there for Gambit. We can see there are a decent amount of wards down by Dragon already. No pinks being placed by now, both supports, and actually Snoopy just picking up a pink ward in there as well. So that Dragon fight may not be too far away.
Yeah, the pink ward just to control vision, and against Gambit, who are renowned for going for early Dragon. I think that's a very smart pickup for Snoopy, especially because he's playing Nasus with his ultimate. It shreds those objectives HP bars, so we'll see how quickly he can make his way down there. For the time being, Darian and Alex are keeping up pressure in the mid lane, while the duo lanes are now facing off against each other in the bottom.
Let's see if they can actually get some decent damage down here. I mean, Darian, okay, not going to be doing masses of damage at this stage, but you can see their cocoon going in. Always a bit of a danger. There is the push finally down from Gambit. Then they are going to be starting off the Dragon, and they are going to have three men there for now. Actually, Darian just trying to keep Snoopy away from that one completely, and this looks like it will be the first Dragon.
That little skirmish guaranteed Dragon for Gambit because of the damage that went down to the Snoopy. He wasn't willing to risk going into the Dragon Pit at 50% HP against an already stacked Gambit team.
Let's look at the CS here again, and in particular this bottom lane, because that has now been caught up nicely, 62 to 58, still in favor of Genja, but that was a lot wider when we mentioned that a little bit earlier on before this switch came around and that kill, of course, the first blood for Evil Geniuses in that top lane. So good stuff on that front. Orianna still leading in the mid lane. Froggen has already got his tier, and that is on its way to being stacked up.
So we'll see how quickly Froggen can get that Seraph's Embrace built up. Yesterday, we actually heard from Cloud9's High. He was talking about Kassadin, and he said there is no need to build a Rod of Ages on Kassadin. He says it's simply not necessary. But we can see Froggen's got the Ruby Crystal, so he'll most likely be building that itemization. And it will give him the HP later, but it does take quite a while to get that power point.
So Wicked has now come down into this mid lane, and Froggen going to go top, thinking he might have a bit of an in there. And we can see the overall statistics there for Kassadin, 11 picks so far in the summer split, and over a 50% win ratio.
And we'll see whether or not which category that falls into right now. As Diamond Prox has moved himself towards this bottom lane, he hasn't been spotted yet. He was outside of the vision range of his opponents. He does have Cataclysm available, so if anybody gets locked in, it's going to be Crepo. You'll see that Vayne should be able to just tumble through those walls.
Yeah, tumble away from that one is Crepo here. Getting nicely slowed down by Voidal. Always a bit of a pain, that one. Snoopy is still waiting here for this one. Diamond just at the back. Are we going to see a big fight kicking off down in his bottom lane? Here we go. Yellow Peak passes his ultimate. Going to stun up Voidal against the wall, who flashes away. There's a tidal wave coming through. Here comes Froggen now as well. Actually going to get knocked up there, but he will manage to secure the kill. There is Cataclysm going down. Yellow Peak has to flash because he's in range of the turret, as was Snoopy. But I don't think that Gambit have really got what it takes to follow on from this one. The mobility of Froggen going to get him out of danger. And Yellow Peak is going to keep going as well. Genja decided not to chase.
Genja ran out of mana during that encounter, so we didn't get Expunge going down. He wasn't able to get ambushed down to chase down his, chase his opponents. They end up trading support for support, but overall, a pretty good fight for Evil Geniuses.
Yeah, that kill coming in for Froggen, something that, falling behind there would definitely be very happy for. That's given him that catalyst to protector.
So we'll see how quickly he can get his tier charged up and his items completed, because that's when those Kassadins become terrifying. Diamond Prox is just trying to babysit Genja now. With the minion wave being so far pushed against Genja's tower, he almost gets a knock-up. Yellow Feet very cheekily tumbles away.
Yeah, he was obviously stood on a wall there, so he knew exactly when that was coming, trying to bait him out of that one completely. And Pete deciding not to go back from this one. He's deciding to stick in that lane and make sure that he doesn't fall further behind and almost get back to square one, which he was in before they got that first blood up in the top lane.
The one thing we have to keep an eye on this bottom lane is that both Flash and Barrier are still available for Genja. So if Voidal is able to put some more poke down or find Yellow Peak or Crepo out of position, we could actually see Gambit going in, because they know that the exhaust is down for their opponents, so it could play into their favor.
That Sea Cripple looked like he was just going to maybe put a ward down in the Tri-Bush, make sure that Diamond doesn't come sneaking down, and that's exactly what he will do from that one. That's up in this top lane. Similar things being done by both Froggen and Darien there to make sure that they've got that vision. Snoopy is waiting here inside of the brush, and Darien might find himself in a little bit of trouble. Where's the rappel? There it is, coming down onto the back line there, that final minion. But will he be able to get away from Froggen? He's going to use a flash on this. No tower, of course, behind him. Here comes Wicked from the side. Can they lock this one up? Let's bounce being used, and there is a second kill for Froggen.
Very well played by Evil Genius, as Froggen and Snoopy setting that one up, and Wicked just closing the kill. Very crucially, he didn't even use his Ignite. He could have guaranteed that kill with a Summoner spell, but realized they had the damage with Let's Bounce and the Rift Walk to chase it up. It also sets them up to steal this blue buff now.
Well, Alex just had his ward taken away, still waiting in there. Let's see if he goes in, throws the ball. A little bit too late though, Snoopy gets that one away.
And Diamond Frox instantly responds. There's three members top, he's got enough damage done, you know, plus his smite available to steal this blue away, and they end up just trading buffs for the second time this game.
Well, if anyone knows how to take buffs away, it's probably going to be Diamond at the end of the day. And Alex saying, well, that's actually worked out better for us in a way, because I've got this blue buff. Froggen's going to be nowhere near that blue buff. That's gone to Snoopy instead. So quite happy with that trade, Gambit, I'm sure.
Yeah, the next couple of minutes is definitely going to play into their favor. And with Alex already having a 60 CS advantage over Froggen's Kassadin, it is something that's very good. We should actually take a look at the gold, because even though it is 60 and that looks terrifying, it only equates to around 450 or 500 gold between the two champions. So it's not quite as scary as the numbers appear to be.
Froggen now got that blasting one in there, and there are the numbers for you. So see that one and how it's all working out. Pete right now, 10 CS behind, and as such, around about 400 gold behind from that one as well. He, two assists on Pete, not really bringing him quite up to that level that he would have hoped by now, but Froggen certainly being kept in that one with the kills, that's for sure. It's Wicked here, taking a lot of damage from Alex, and that's the problem that they're going to run into with this one. Got that blue buff on now, Alex. His next couple of minutes going to be very nice for him.
And right now, Genja's in such a good power position. He has his Blade of the Rune King already completed. Yellow Peter is playing very dangerously here because he only has the Bilgewater Cutlass. He's got enough money to finish the items, but for this little period, it's Genja in the power position.
Well, I just hear that. Of course, they decide, you know what, let's equal that one up and go back and pick that up. So here's Dragon number two just spawning in. Gambit, no real surprise, has got the timing down to absolute perfection. And you know, that aggression alone from Genja has taken EG out of the bottom lane and given Gambit even more safety on the Dragon.
Yeah, and Yellow Pete was sitting on the money for a while. He had about 400 or 500 gold extra. He could have finished his Blade earlier, which meant if he had done that, you know, purchase, they maybe could have challenged for that Dragon. But Evil Genius is not in a position, didn't have the timer for it, and effectively just gave that one away to Gambit for free.
So we already saw a little bit of a probable sign of things to come here, I think we can say, for Evil Genius. And that was Froggen pushing this top lane completely onto the inner turret. Luckily for them, or I say luckily for them, I mean, Darien has gone home guard boots here, so he knows that he can get back to that inner turret relatively quickly to stop Froggen really doing too much.
What you're seeing right now down this bottom lane, Yellow Pete and Krepo can out-duel Genja and Voidal. Vayne with Blade of the Rune King in comparison to Twitch is going to be a much better 1v1 or 2v2 duelist. If you had a team fight, however, Genja would be in the power position. So Yellow Pete and Krepo will try to find a pick. If a single bubble lands, that's going to be a dead rat.
Yeah, I'm going to go straight in for those ones, no doubt about that one. Still, that 10 CS lead persists for Genja, but now the turret's starting to take damage. And now Gambit, they've got the ability to slow, to use that polymorph from Voidal as well, and the slow out of Genja, but they've not quite got the lockup potential that you have there with that Nami of the Bubble, then the Tidal Wave to follow through, a Condemn here as well to really knock things about. As Genja actually going to take a lot of damage, flashes away from the Bubble.
Good flash, and the reason this is such a scary position for Genja, the tumble damage from Vayne is maxed out. So that's adding around 50, 60 damage on a tumble. And with Krepo almost hitting max on his E, Tidecaller's Blessing, that's 70 damage for 3 auto attacks. Simply put, Genja cannot deal with that additional on-hit damage. One thing we're seeing this mid lane, Wicked's been left to fend off Alex for the last 4 or 5 minutes because Froggen wants space to breathe in that top lane.
Yeah, space to breathe though is almost given Alex more space to breathe as well. I mean, it's 197 as we are going to see them coming down to the bottom. Teleport coming in. Voidal going to get locked up. Tidal Wave coming across, but they don't seem to have the damage. Diamond coming in as well. He's pretty much the protector of this team in the bottom lane.
Diamond scares away Yellow Pete and Crepo, and Yellow Pete was tanking up all of the tower hits, which meant they couldn't stay there for as long as they wanted to. Snoopy is coming to join the party. You can see Wicked roaming around towards his bottom lane as well. This is going to become a 4v4, 5v4 very, very quickly.
And only Alex really not there at this point, as EG looking like they want to try and force the turret. Wicked charging up on the backside as Froggen goes in. He's tanking up the turret, has to flash away. As Diamond going to dive in on towards Snoopy at the back, but it's Genja that's taking all the damage. He will go down. Yellow Pete might be able to get a second kill for EG. He will as he takes down Darien. And that was a great run of play. Alex Itch now out of position as well.
Great shockwave, pull Snoopy and Wicked back. Alex is going to try run away, not going to be enough.
No, I don't think he can escape this one. Wicked going in there, gets the knock-up onto him. This should be a simple case of just finishing off from this. Bubble comes in from Crepo, and Yellow Pete picks up another one, a vital second kill. The turret's going to fall as well.
Two very important things about the course of that fight. First and foremost, Yellow Pete did not get locked up in that cataclysm for anywhere near long enough, and Evil Geniuses focused down Genja so incredibly hard. Once he was down, the damage threat just simply wasn't there, and Vayne was allowed to tear through the rest of Gambit. So great play from EG, but they're only 800 gold ahead because their opponents have two dragons.
Yeah, those two dragons coming down. The next one not going to be too far away from things here as well, so we'll see how that one goes in. Whether Evil Geniuses will now feel all of a sudden a lot more comfortable to be getting involved with those dragons. And we can see that Wicked, you know, playing Zaka champion, which he's so, so comfortable on. He's absolutely not scared of anything right now. Got that Spirit Visage in there, which obviously going to give him that extra magic resist, which against someone like Darien's Elise will be making him a happy man. And now EG coming down for another steal on the blue.
They've had the timer on this one since the very beginning of the game. Diamond's going forward because he feels confident his team is there to back him up. And we do see the blue. It actually gets taken away by Snoopy thanks to a very good smite. He landed that one.
Smite coming in, and I wonder if EG are now going to rotate quickly over to Odes there. And Blue, but Froggen coming in here.
He's
oh,
he's
misjudged
way.
It. Diamond's gone away. Oh, my God. Froggen. And
he's not a double lift. Double lift did a blind dive over the wall yesterday. He picked up a kill. Close, but no cigar. And you can see that as EG are moving towards maybe their blue area, you can feel Froggen. Maybe he should get in there and take that blue buff.
Well, we'll have a look at that one, because Gambit not really in a position to do that one with Diamond just going back. But once he comes back in there with full HP, they might feel like they can challenge for that one and get it back over to Alex Itch here once again. Few wards going down by Crepo inside of the Gambit jungle, so they want to make sure that they keep vision up on that side of the map. And that may just be enough here to force Gambit into a second thought of about whether they can go in and steal that blue.
Yeah, we'll have to see. Not only that, with Dragon coming up, this could be the timer for Gambit to start grouping towards the bottom half of the map. Darien, if he recalls, has got those home guard boots that he can run down very, very quickly. And you can see that with Crepo, he's been warding out. Oh, Genja's been caught by Yellow Pete.
Oh, Yellow Pete popping the ulti. Genja just stealthing away from that one and saying, nope, you're not going to catch me out. And Lulu actually coming in from the back here. Voidal going to look to support his teammate. But we've got that Zeal now added in as well. And we can see the Evil Geniuses are doing their own blue buff. So unless Diamond's able to sneak in there, he'd actually just put a pink ward down by Dragon. Decides not to. That's a blue buff. Finally on their own side of the map for EG.
And for the first time in a long time, EG now have timing and positioning and vision control to play for this Dragon. They delayed picking their blue buff earlier because they knew roughly when Dragon was coming up. And you can see Crepo, he's placed a string of wards across the map, which are now routinely being taken out by Gambit, which signals, hey, Dragon's coming up. Teleport is not available for Froggen, but will be shortly. So this could become a next big fight for both teams.
Bit of a pink ward war going down there. As Crepo choosing to put his pink in there instead of actually going with the Oracle for that one, which obviously now in 3.9 persists through death, so a little bit less risky to do something like that, but you don't want to give a kill away, whatever the weather, whether you've got an Oracle or not. So Dragon is available now. Both teams going to dance around this one. Froggen not quite there, but look at his cooldown on Teleport just come off, so he can get involved.
Okay, so the key to a team fight here for Gambit is if Evil Geniuses go into the Dragon Pit and they stack up for an Orianna ultimate hit on two or three of them, that's going to be scary for EG. The Orianna ultimate plus Twitch spray and pray will tear them apart. What you do see though is Gambit get positioning and they take down the tower in mid. They've caught our Wicked.
Yeah, they've caught our Wicked. He's going to try and let's bounce himself away from that one. The Ignite not quite enough to take him, no, at least pop his passive from this point as we see Diamond here inside of the jungle going in on towards Snoopy and Crepo. Crepo decided to flash away from that one and Gambit decided not to follow in. Now EG are moving on to this bottom side. Are we going to see him fight again?
Teleport is up if Frogger wants to join. Tidal Wave is available here for Crepo as well. So even though he's taken damage, if they can kite, if they can stay spread out, EG can maybe make something work. Here comes Frogger.
Frogger in from the side. They managed to catch Alex Itch there in all kinds of trouble with the bubble, but the Wild Growth goes down. Crepo's a dead man. He flashed earlier on, don't forget. And now Yellow Pete on the bottom side. He's already lost two teammates in this fight. The Dragon looking like it should be in there for Gambit as well. Will be smited away by Diamond in the end. Wicked is still there. Alex going very low. Froggen going to come in and assassinate him. Can they get any more from this one? Darien going super low as well. That will be a kill this time for Wicked.
Here
as Yellow
Pete
has come back into it. Genja goes down before he can stealth up there. The Flash is coming out, but Void will get slowed. He's a dead man as well. Froggen now unstoppable at 5-0-4.
Brilliant comeback from Evil Geniuses. The start of the fight was questionable at best. They went into a team that was stacked and grouped up and just got collapsed on. But the kiting power, they stayed split up. You had Froggen in the top, Wicked directly in the middle, and Yellow Peach just backing in and out and in and out long enough for them to close up. Picking up a tower and four kills, well worth that trade.
Yep, and this one should be going down as well here, tanking that one up as now Wicked has even got his passive to rely on. Doesn't quite need it there though. Will be able to just simply walk away from that one. So, funnily enough, it was Wicked who got low at the start of that very encounter between the outer and inner turrets in the mid lane. He had the time to get back into it, and the tankiness of him and that, you know, the let's bounce, which did a great job for them earlier on there, for him to escape, obviously wasn't available, but the fact is that he's still a menace with the knockup that he has from the slingshot, with the slow that he's got as well, he can still lock people down.
The carries, the important players for Evil Geniuses were alive. Zac, Kassadin, and Vayne. And they did not stay stacked up long enough for the team of Gambit to focus them down. Gambit looked towards one target as Wicked jumped in, and it allowed Froggen and Pete to just deal damage from the sides. Then the second that Pete and Froggen got looked at, they just went, nope, don't want none of that, backed away, and came back in as Gambit were split focused. So as long as EG can keep controlled chaos like that, they can continue winning team fights.
So 25 minutes in, as the chaos breaks a little bit, it gives us time to look over where things are. Evil Geniuses, pretty much for the first time here, I think, since First Blood, have themselves a nice gold lead. It's only 1,000 gold, though, which is definitely nothing to really write home about. But they got in there. They know the timing on that last dragon. They know that they can fight for them now. They've got three turrets to their name as well. And if they have control, I think this middle outer turret here for Gambit may be crucial in them holding on to this game.
The one thing that's very important about that middle tower for Gambit is if it drops, it allows this incredibly mobile Evil Geniuses team access to the jungle even easier. The top outer tower is down, both bottom towers are down, so we could even see EG setting up wards to maybe steal red buffs as it's coming up. And you can see red buff is fully, you know, visioned up for Evil Geniuses and recently. So that tower is crucial to maintaining some semblance of control.
So right now EG just backed away from that one, I think realizing that we probably can't, with 3 versus 4 or 3 versus 5, be sticking around there for that mid turret, but they're going to go for the fight here. Darien taking a lot of damage. He gets Wild Growth up. Yellow Pete caught inside of the Cataclysm, but that's going to be the death of Diamond Proxus. Wicked is finally going to get Cell Division pop, but something tells me EG not done yet. They get away. They flashed away, tumbled away from the Shockwave. That could be massive here. Can EG keep pushing around? We see there that Genja coming from the top side did pretty much nothing in that fight.
1-0 in the fight. They got the Cell Division. Now Froggen is playing brave because his Riftwalk is available, as is his Flash. We'll see whether or not EG continue the number focus in the mid lane and try to take down the tower. That's what they really want. They want that objective very hard.
For such a big fight with so much in it there, it was very low scoring in terms of the kills that were picked up there for, well, for EG in the end of it, of course. That cell division finally popped there for Wicked, 27 minutes 20 into the game, and he's up at 215 CS there, the most in his team, actually, but should still point out the fact of Alex H 288 to the 191, almost 100 CS lead he has over his opponent, and well, six kills is what's giving Froggen the advantage on that side.
Six kills, three towers, and a dragon, and it means that Froggen is actually only 100 gold, or 300 gold, sorry, behind that 100 CS difference, which is massive at this point. And Froggen has been picking his engagements perfectly. There's been no mistakes to when he's gone in and the timing to pick those kills up. Yellow Pete's toying with the idea of going in here on Darien, and I think he's actually got enough damage to do it. Phantom Dancer and Blade. He could be squashing a spider if no one interferes.
Well, Darien is the kind of guy that takes fights whether he's ahead or not. In the past, at least. We'll see if he decides to go for that one. Actually, just going to push the lane out. And I think Pete was a little worried that he was going to be closing on here as Froggen trying to get away from Genja. He gets slowed down, but Riftwalk. He's got Flash available as well. Not able to lock down a Kassadin.
What that does signal, though, is if Kassadin is able to get caught by a Shockwave or even a Cocoon or a Knockup by Jarvan, that's going to be enough time when comboed with Twitch dealing damage to kill them. And it all comes down to Gambit landing the respective crowd controls on more than one member of EG in that previous team fight. Shockwave, even though it wasn't a good position, EG responded. They got out of range thanks to Tumble and Flash and putting distance away. And as long as EG can keep doing that, they're in a good position.
Yeah, and I see there that Yellow Peak constantly on this bottom side of the map, taking away the golems there. Does now have that CS advantage, plus a nice kill advantage, which now setting him up towards that late game. This is the dream position almost for every Vayne coming closer into the 30-minute mark of the game to be ahead in kills, to be ahead in CS and the items as well. As we see there, 5 seconds, Dragon coming up. This is going to be an important one.
So we'll see how well EG can position for this one. The previous time they tried to play with it, they ended up losing a tower because they were out of position for the timer of its spawning. And right now, they're a little bit more focused, but Vayne is not there. Yellow Pete is very far away as Diamond Frogs eats a huge amount of damage from Froggen's Kassadin.
Yeah, and that forces them back straight away there, saying, okay, so they know Dragon's up. We can't quite sneak in towards that one as Genja here. Is he going to get caught out? Yellow Pete coming in from the side. Tidal Wave comes across, but doesn't really hit anyone. There's a Cataclysm coming down. Froggen now coming in from the side. Voidal uses Wild Growth on his own. Snoopy will fall down in this, and Darien still on high HP as Froggen Rift walks over, mops up Voidal, and that will leave us right now with a 2-for-1 in favor of EG. Froggen not done just yet, though, as he's still chasing down towards Diamond, who manages to slide away from that.
Bubble.
There's a great bubble. Two men picked up in that one. That's going to be two more kills here for EG, and they both go to Yellow Pete.
Yellow Pete was not touched at the beginning of the fight. Froggen even manages to pick up a kill onto Diamond Prox, trying to get away in the back line. That was actually all started because Genja tried to stealth up and deliver the ball, deliver a shockwave into the guts of Evil Geniuses, and they didn't group up. They didn't stack up, so it didn't happen. The counterattack came down, and EG with the ace, the tower, and probably Baron.
Looking for the first Baron of the game. I say first Baron of the game because if the match history between these two teams anything to go by, it might not be the last, but EG got a commanding lead now in this one. 44.7 before Baron up to 46.5, let's call it, to 41,000. So a very solid lead built just from that fight and the Baron pickup. Obviously taking down the outer turret as well. They should, by all rights, get this dragon as well.
Yeah, Snoopy's going to be able to solo this one probably before anybody can contest. However, it's taking him a long time to get that one down. Right now, Evil Geniuses, they've constantly showed they can pick kills up, and they're going to continue to try do so. Snoopy may try stick around for a smite steal.
Well, Diamond does have Smite as well, which he actually mistimed there, by the way, which Super Pro was watching and think, damn it, that could have been my chance to actually steal that one. Obviously, it doesn't quite work out, but that was Dragon number 4 here for Gambit. And now, EG have had a lot of control on the map since early on, but they've not been able to hold on to that Baron. You have to wonder, if they've taken those 4 Barons as well, this game might be close to over, if not already done for EG.
Yeah, they would have been able to have that massive item advantage, which they currently are building towards. You can see a Guardian Angel now completed for Yellow Pete. The only threat from his opponents is that Shockwave Spray and Pray combo. And once that's down, Yellow Peach should be able to sustain most of the damage unless everyone's on him. And with the GA as well, even if he doesn't, he's got a second lease on life to do it all again.
Yeah, if you just look down the scores there on the EG side, Wicked 2-0-10 with the Zac in there, Frozen Heart, Spirit Visage going in there for the Oleandra's Torment as well for that bit of extra damage. Froggen now got the Rabadon's Death Cap added into his Rod of Ages and Xerath's Embrace. We already talked about Yellow Pete in there. So now, if the fight goes well for EG, a team which we always used to say, you know, if you look back to CLG versus Moscow five times, that EG team fighting phases were the team to beat probably in the world.
And we'll have to see whether or not they've still got it, because it's been a little questionable in the last couple of months. Right now, though, it definitely looks like the team of old is busy playing, albeit with slightly different champions. And Yellow Pete's Vayne is absolutely phenomenal. Froggen and Wicked, they've set themselves up. The slingshot is charged. They pull the trigger.
And Genja's dead. Yeah, I mean, that was obviously a very easy kill to pull off for EG. Rift Walk plus the slingshot coming straight in. And while the Rat stands no chance of getting himself away from that one, Genja's like, I just wanted a little bit more farm, guys, in that top lane. But now they might lose the inhibitor.
Oh, they've got him.
Actually, they're going for the fight here. Alex gets caught with a bubble. Tidal wave coming through. Diamond now right at the back of the team while we focus down. Yellow Pete's going crazy at the front. He gets another one. And just like that, four men down for Gambit without a single reply.
40 seconds on the clock for three members of Gambit. They're going to be able to finish this one out. Yellow Pete has had three or four team fights in a row where he has not taken a single point of damage. They've got the first Nexus turret down. They've got the next one down. This guarantees a 3-0 head-to-head record. In the event of ties, Evil Geniuses will advance ahead of Gambit.
So there we go then. Evil Geniuses taking down Gambit for the third time in a row here. The two big European teams from Season 2 going at it once again. And you see what it means to EG, and I think to Snoopy in particular as well. Did he actually die in that game? He did die twice, which is two times more than he's died in the previous two games. I say two times, but there's not really anything times zero. So it's two times more than he did, technically, because he died twice.
In three games, two deaths to his name. That's the summary.
That's it.
I'm more impressed at the fact that Snoopy's picked the game to play where he's confident in his ability to affect the matchup. He did it against MYM. He was key in getting Yellow Pete two kills early on in the bottom lane. He did it here, was key in setting up First Blood in the top lane. And perfect play from Evil Geniuses as far as the team composition and who plays is concerned.
And you know, one thing we always used to talk about with Gambit is Diamond and his ability to really impact on the enemy jungle. This time around, if we think back to the blue buff of Gambit, well, it wasn't really Gambit's blue buff at all. I don't think one time that they even... Maybe they got it once. The second spawn, maybe. Or certainly they didn't have it a lot. That's the point. They were constantly on it, right on its spawn.
Very early on, Diamond was able to at least counteract that by stealing away EG's blue buff, so they traded a couple times. And actually, that worked out better early on because the traded blue went to Alex. But as the game progressed and they lost the towers, they lost control, and they lost the team fights, EG were in their jungle more often than they were in their own jungle. I mean, Yellow Pete was alone in the bottom lane. Crepo was deep warding the red and the bottom half of the map throughout the entirety of the match. And EG just had complete map presence and map control.
And that's something something that doesn't often get said. Is you know, props to Crepo in there as well for the fact that as soon as that bottom outer turret went down, he spent a lot of time and a lot of gold as well, putting those wards down constantly on that bottom side. And once Gambit realized that they didn't have control there, they realized that they couldn't go through and continue to steal that blue buff away to counteract it. And, well, EG, great game from them.
And one of the things that Crepo was doing, which I thought was absolutely brilliant, was that as he was moving through the jungle, he casted his E, his on-hit slow on himself, and attacked moved, I believe it's attack moved, into the bushes. So even though he was face-checking, he was like, well, if somebody's there, I'm going to slow them. My finger's on Q, I'm going to bubble them, and I should be fine to get away. And it was very good, decisive play, even on an invade like that, to be that forward-thinking. So props to EG.
Yeah, and obviously, as we said before we started things off, a good weekend for Evil Geniuses here and a bad weekend for Gambit can pretty much throw them in opposite directions in the table. I mean, that sounds very obvious. You get points when you win games and you don't get any points when you lose them. But because of how close things are now, EG moving up to 10 for 11, Gambit will be set on 11 for 10. They're only one win away from leveling it right up with them.
Yeah, it's very, very scary. I mean, if either of these players pick up wins now. It's one win ahead of Ninjas in Pyjamas. It's two losses behind Meet Your Makers, for example. It's too close to call. So it's just a matter of seeing how the rest of the games go and then saying, well, let's make what we can of it.
And that's the funny thing is, it's just getting closer all the time, and there's absolutely no way to even predict who's going to be finishing in the top spot or in the bottom spot. That's why we love it over here in Europe. So let's head over to Demon and Jason to break down EG versus Gambit.
Thank you very much, Joe. And well, what a great game. And that's now 3-0 for Evil Geniuses. They were happy with that score to start with, a 2-0. They're just like, this is the one we can win.
Well, I mean, the thing is, what do you remember? We're so close to the end of the season. Every matchup series really counts because you want to have that up against the other team. Because if you do are obviously tied with them at the end of the season, you have to be up one more game to, you know, kind of skip that tiebreaker game, that game of one to really get into the playoffs. But yeah, it was really interesting to see what happened because EG, they just kind of ran away with it the entire time. Like, that wasn't really even a close game.
And we've talked about it, you know, throughout the whole season, really, the fact that there's 2 weeks left. There's 12 matches this week, 3 for each team and 5 next week. These are so important now, these matches. And to win a game against Gambit, who were second themselves, for Evil Genius, who were sat down that bottom of the league, it's a big confidence boost. Big confidence boost for Snoopy as well coming in. Obviously, Shaq has been sat around. He was sat behind him there. They were like actually saying, Shaq is going to do the mouse. Snoopy's going to do the keyboard. We got this covered.
Yeah, I mean, you have to give him a lot of credit because during the entire game, we had a replay to show you, but it's the whole thing of where EG picked their fights. Every single fight they picked up was really like calculated. Like, all right, we're going to fight here, we're going to fight here. And they always won those fights pretty heavily handed. But the one fight at Dragon in particular, where you saw Snoopy die right away, you saw Krepo die right away. And even though Gambit picked up the Dragon, he was in the end of 4-2 because EG just kept bouncing in and back and forward with Froggen on his Cassian jumping in. Wicked, who was a little bit late to the party, ended up showing up anyways and made some big plays. And then Yellow Pete, who I really have to give him credit, his Vayne was very strong because in that fight, he got pushed out right away, but he would run back in just to get Genja's attention. So Genja would chase him down instead of going for Froggen, who's in the middle of the pit. And because of that, they were able to turn the fight around completely. It was really well done. It kind of shows a lot of growth within EG.
And Froggen tried that a couple of times. He teleported in a number of times. Sometimes it worked, sometimes it didn't quite work.
Yeah, the first one did not work out well. He was level 4, left the lane very early on, which you don't really want to do as a Kassadin. And because of that, you end up falling about 30 CS behind in the middle of the game. But obviously, it didn't matter in the end since he was able to snowball the kills. But that's a teleport. That's like the pros and cons. It can either work out really well for you or work out horribly for you. And luckily for him, it kind of had a little bit of both, so he was able to make up for it.
And what do you think overall it is that Evil Geniuses has over Gambit? I mean, is it just simply the years of experience from playing them that they just know what to do against Gambit now?
Yeah, it's really like a long history behind these two teams. We have to think back to, I believe it was IAM Kiev, where they actually, Gambit actually beat them now, or known as Moscow 5 then, but I think it's a little bit of that, and it's a little bit of N-Rated coming into the team, because we can't overlook that fact where he's brought in a lot of analysis. He's really helped show them where they would be arguing over, oh, we threw the game there, oh, we messed up there. And he's like, yeah, but guys, what about this moment? And they're all like, oh, yeah, that was a good moment. But I think it shows that with him coming to the team, with Shaker coming to the team, with everyone stepping up, they've really upped their game.
Well, it was a fantastic performance. We are, of course, going to go over to Shox, who is standing by with Yellow Pete.
Thank you very much. Congratulations, Yellow Pete. Impressive victory. So going into picks and bans, how wary were you of the fact that, of course, Gambit could pull out something special like the Karma Jungle we saw last time around? So how did you get into that one?
Well, that one we obviously knew from last week. We decided it wasn't really a priority pick or ban for us. So we just wanted to let that go through if we really wanted to play it. And we just left Jarvan open as well. So we basically had to choose, and Jarvan is a jungler he really likes to play. The other picks were not really predicted by us. Like, we wouldn't have necessarily expected Elise or Twitch, but yeah, it wasn't really anything extraordinary anyway, so.
So eventually you ended up in a 2-versus-2 lane. So how did you fare as Vayne and Nami against a Twitch Lulu lineup?
Early game was kind of rough. They like had a lot of lane presence and poked us really well. We just basically got back into the game with that one gank where they didn't have vision from lane side, and Snoopy managed to get really, really close. And yeah, from there it wasn't really that hard anymore. We could just tie farm and pressure them and eventually dive them bottom lane with the Kassadin TP.
Yeah, you guys had Snoopy in the jungle for this game. How different is it for your lane specifically? How different do you play, or what other things you put emphasis on when it is Snoopy in the jungle instead of Shaker?
I don't think it's that much different. I think Shaker overall prefers to gank the 2v2 lane a little bit more than Snoopy, but it's not essentially that different.
And the lane up against Voidal, in opposed to playing against Darker, is he more aggressive, is he less aggressive? What does he pull out in lane?
I haven't played against Darker too much, so it's really hard to say. In this game, Voidal was really, really present, especially in lane. Later in the game, he couldn't really, he didn't really have much impact, but it's not necessarily his fault. I think he did really well for what he could do.
Yeah, not his fault, because you guys were pretty a lot ahead. But of course, Gambit is one of those teams that they can just come back in the game and farm that goal back up by taking objectives. So how did you prevent them from doing that and being able to close it out?
We had really, really strong 1v1 and like dueling champions and also ganking potential. So we decided instead of going for our usual approach of like sieging towers, we would rather split a little bit more and catch them off guard. And then in the end, that worked. Like with one man down, we could eventually dive as well. So that was our approach.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Now we need to take a short break, but stick with us. Last week, Alternate got evicted from their home at the top of the leaderboard. They'd like to move back up, but SK is in no mood to help.